Shabbat Shalom, Yisrael. Greetings to the elect of Yisrael scattered abroad throughout the nations of the earth that Yah has elected according to his sovereign wisdom, his understanding of all things, without any input from us or any being. He has made his election of Yisrael and the calling of his people sure. He needs no input in that election. He needs no counseling at all in that election, for he is the one that has elected a people to establish the riches of his power, his might, his wisdom, his understanding, that the nations, the goyim of the earth, shall marvel at the beauty of that people. And as we, as a nation of Yisrael, if we began to become more complicit, and that is simply complying, obeying what he commands us, then we will see this progressive power of growth, as we can see through the chronicles of the written book. When they were turned back to their master, to the great one, to Almighty Yahweh, we could see his strength, his power, his victorious might prevailing in that people, that the weapons of the greatest kingdoms of darkness could not prevail against them. And it must be so in this hour, with the remnant of Yisrael scattered to the four corners of the earth, that we should make a statement by the power of his name. There is no other name given on the Shabbat, but we may gather under the ominous presence of Almighty Yah, but through the power of Yeshua HaMashiach. And for that I do barach him, for that Yisrael. I do want to greet you all that have joined us on the U live stream, you that have join us by the way of the live audio and video stream that goes forth from here out of Yahweh's congregation in the midst of Teshua Victory Community. We greet you all in Yeshua's mighty name. I do want you that have concerns concerning our precious Ach Yahuba there in Jacksonville, Florida. I talked with him on yesterday, and he is looking to be released from the hospital potentially next week as he continue to strive and battle in the midst of the agony of the opposition, that he lose not his imuna. So let us remember him in prayer, and that we make pala unto Yah, that we intercede, that we come before Yah with a sincere objective and motive, not seeking our own, but the welfare of the body of Yisrael. And also we greet our Ach David and Suzanne Yah there in Britain. We want to say to you, family of Yisrael, we do appreciate your kind gift that we received on this week all the way from Britain. May the riches of Yah rest upon you all, your home. May you fill it with the light, the wisdom of Yeshua HaMashiach, as well as our Ach David, David Nesha and his family there in Birkenhead, Scotland. He wrote me this morning. I wanted to read the letter. He informed me of the tremendous winds that are battling that nation and how that the winds get up to 165 miles an hour. And by the mercies of Almighty Yah, he says that their home is standing, the ground is frozen to the depth that you cannot even plow the ground. And yet these mercenaries of darkness, the ones that are greedy as children of hell for monies, they put such a task upon the people that you must order a certain amount of oil to stay warm, whereby the temperatures are 0 Celsius. That is minus 12, 15 degrees is what the temperature is in that nation upon that land. And yet Yah was able to open a door whereby he could get access to oil, not exacting all of their little finance that it takes to try to make some inroads for his family to eat, to have a place to sleep, and to stay warm. Having food and raiment therewith, Yisrael, we must be very contented. We also greet our Achart there in Florida with the family of Yisrael. Greetings to you, my friend. And we do toda you all for your tremendous support and all of your gifts, your offerings of great kindness that you have granted by the wisdom of Yah, that the labor of Yah can be strengthened here in Teshua community, and that we can continue in the path that Yah grants unto us to walk in. All of our friends, you are givers. Also to you, our precious Achotz Pamela Washington, there in Ohio. May the strength of Yah rest upon you, and may he guard the doorposts of your home as our Ach Lester there. May he strengthen your body, raise you up. And our precious friend Richard there in the state of Texas, greetings to you, our friend. And also, there are many of the others, not many, I don't like to use that word, but there are others. I may not call your name, but you're in the heart of Yisrael. We want to greet our precious Ach Bobby there in Louisiana. May Yah strengthen your bosom. May he cause the power and the light of Yeshua HaMashiach rise up in you, and a great strength and a great power. To all of our Zachin, to all of those that Yah has granted his wisdom unto, to all of those that he has given the inspiration to our Amore, and all those that are of the nature of the Nobi, we greet you all in Yahshua's mighty name, and may he cover you with the dam of Yahshua, with the wisdom of his Torah, that we may instruct Beit Yisrael how to walk before the Most High, to bring before him the offerings that are acceptable in his sight. We're living in a time whereby the most devious, diabolical powers of hell are running the age. Yah has granted unto the wicked a space, for the nations, the earth, is given into the hands of the Rasha, the wicked, those that are criminals against Yah. We can see that in every application of life in this land, in the nations that are afar off, we can see one of the most devious, malicious power structure that is ruling and dominating with great oppression the minds of the masses. As Yah said, that this uth, the mark, it is not only the mark of the beast, but it is the mark of man and the beast. We must understand the subtleties to open up the doors unto those things that are profound. When I utilize the word profound, it is beyond the ability for man to extract from the laws the wisdom of Yah, unless the mind of the Most High speaks unto that man. They cannot be deducted by some mathematical formulation or some kind of philosophy that has been refined by its philosophizing of matters. It cannot come that way. It must come by the wisdom and the revelation of the wisdom of Yah that he imparts into man. He is going to use man. Man is the gem of Yah. He is the capstone of his creation. He has created the Melechim. He has created the oasis of the great device of Hashemaam, that they are beyond our ability to see, to understand the depth. He has created the vastness of the oceans of the sea, that we will never understand the depths of that. And yet, he brought forth something that is so fragile and weak. And he placed the crown of his honor upon his skita, his crown, upon a creature that has been created out of the dust of the earth. And not only that, but he poured his promises into the love of that creature. And allow that even the storms of darkness cannot prevail against that creature. The ring of the mass forces of hell and darkness cannot dethrone him from where Yah has set him above high, that he has given him dominion over all things. He has granted that unto a nation of people, that will be exercised in like no other people upon the earth. Don't tell me Yah doesn't possess favor, because he does. Don't tell me he doesn't discriminate, because he does. Don't tell me he does not possess a nation and a people that he has elected. He does. That's his nature. I want to continue in the process. Yah's will. In the teaching of the mark, 666 of man and beast. It is when the mind, or the capstone of that mind, it is so diabolical that the very nature of Hoshotzah operates in that mind. It has the power of Hamas, of great cruelty and oppression, to divide, to destroy, to totally annihilate the very presence, the manifestation of the power of the mighty one that created all things, to distort in the conscience, the mind of man, that he may have his power of his kingdom established in that mind. And Yah says that's the beginning, or man in his imperfections, that he will not proceed from that. When a man receives that mark, he will not proceed from that state of being. He is lost. He is given over unto the gates of darkness, for hell and its power manifest in that mind, in that being, in that conscience. And there is a diabolical attempt through their malicious intent to destroy everything that represents the beauty of Almighty Yahweh and Yahshua HaMashiach. So it is a mark of man. It is a mark of the beast. It is the mark of the power of his governments that rules by the power of great darkness in the mind of man, that he is eternally lost, and there is no tikvah, no hope, no promise for that one that receives that mark. We cannot skirt the issues. This is a process of teaching. You cannot do it in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months, a year, 2 years of teaching. It is a progressive type of wisdom that Yah reveals unto us. And I'm going to simply try in the next 2 months, Yah's will, to open up the doors that will cause our levim to be so impatient that we strive to seek out the depth of this wisdom and knowledge that he has opened unto a people that's so frail and so weak. Unless Yah is on our side, we're not going to make it. I want to again go to the Achrit, the last of the latter. I want to begin here in the book and revisit this verse that we began on last week in the book of Gilead, Revelation. In the 13th chapter and verse 18. As the messenger of Yah speaks unto this time, to a people of this time, he speaks with a profound utterance. And that is simply that the kara, the utterance, cannot be contained within the vessel of his clay earthen body. And so he utters by the power of Almighty Yah, as he cries aloud unto Yisra'iyah for this age, for this time. He says to understand or to understand the power of wisdom. Here is wisdom. In all of our wisdom, in all of our knowledge, in all of our experience, we must get this wisdom. It is vitally important. I was hoping that I would get to a point today to show you how important it is to get this wisdom. But I will not get there today, but I promise you on next Shabbat, I will. And it is going to startle us because we have read it so often, if we ever open the book, that the simplicity and the importance of it, it is very vital to our chukmah, to our wisdom, our skillful nature to operate within the context of the living Torah. As the power of the testimony of Yeshua speaks to our mind, it does not speak to the mind of the mark of the Uth of man. It does not speak to that mind. There must be a Brit Milah. There must be a cutting away of the foreskin. And when this mind is established, there is nothing left for it but the utter destruction of Sheol, of death, hell, the underworld, the grave, and into the darkness of hell. And that is the only answer. And for y'all to give us some kind or any kind of confidence as to understand the measure of this mind, he must point it out in the Torah. He must point it out in the writings of the Nabi. It must be. And if it's not there, all of this is a damnable lie. We know that it is imat. It is truth. And we will strive to point that out today to show you this mind of Hamas. It is cruel against Yah. It is a mind of cruelty. It is the mind of one of the most vindictive natures that one could ever conjure. One cannot even conjure this mind. This must be birthed by the father of all deceptions, whereby the strength of his kingdom, or the zira, the seed of his kingdom, is in our bosom. And the only thing that comes forth out of us are children of destruction, perdition, and darkness. So here is Yisra'iyah, the Chokhmah, our ability to become skillful in the wisdom of the knowledge of Yah, that we can skillfully use the mind or the concepts of the mind of Yah. He says, let us, all Yisra'iyah, we should have the being or the understanding that we have the readiness to have the attentiveness unto Yah, unto what he speak, that we may perceive with discernment the value of what Yah speaks unto us. That's what wisdom does. Wisdom is principle. But in all of our guidance, we must get being, or the binah, the understanding of Almighty Yahweh. We must be able to perceive. We must be able to discern with all attentiveness as to what Yah speaks unto us in this hour, Yisra'iyah. He says, first of all, I want you, Yisra'iyah, to suffer, to count. It is one thing that the numerics of the science of mathematics, it is accurate. Man may not understand the definitive of it, but it's accurate. On the first and on the seventh day, he rested. And that pattern and that concept, it is embedded in the mind of his creation. That's why you, Zachar, remember, it is there. His nature expressed that. It is the power that his mind is in tune with that. And I don't care how men try to distract from that. It is amazing. I want to inject this. It is amazing that all of these mitzvah of Yah, they're not difficult to understand. They're not difficult to be aware of. And yet when it comes to the fourth Jew, Zachah Shabbat, You got these damn deceivers talking about lunar Sabbath and this. It does not say lunar Shabbat. He tells us to zakah HaShabbat. Do you know what it is to commit adultery and to murder? Why is it that one so difficult? You know what it is to build an image or to have a damn God before you? And these damn deceivers and liars, what they are. And I stand against you all. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Yet all his mitzvah are so precise. They're easily understood, but the Shabbat. That is a lie out of the gates of hell. These ignorant, unlearned men. I don't give a damn what Philo said. I don't care what the writer said. I care what the book, what his mitzvah said. He just simply said, Zachar. Let it become a zikron, a memorial. And man has not, he has always had a remnant that it was a zikron. I don't give a damn about the naming of days. Yah says, Yom Rishon, Yom Shere, Yom Hashishe. And then when he got to the Shabbat, that was the only one that he named Shabbat. It is not difficult. Don't be taken by these damn twisted doctrines. They're not prophets. They're weak, shallow men. And let me get back to this. Hallelujah. Let us that have been the wisdom, the discernment of Yah, let us shafa. We must be exact. We cannot be 1% off. As we hear often from Zachin Benjamin, 99.9% will not be sufficient. We must be precise. And the Safar, it identifies that we must be precise. Was Yahshua precise in the days that he was spent in the belly of the earth? He was precise. It was exact. So we must be exact. That's what we have. All of this determination by the deduction of man, by corrupt minds, telling you who are those that are the anti-Hamashiach. It is a mindset, it is a conscience that defies the true identity of the Most High. It is a mind that rejects Torah. It is a mind that embraces doctrines of hell and that rejects Yah. It is a mind that is in opposition of Almighty Yah. It is a mind that has the spirit of Hamas, that it is cruel against Yah. It despises Yah. And it is not of the descriptive superlatives that we can measure the very intent and the power of that mind. It must be revealed. And the only way that Yah can reveal it, he shows us the mark of man. And it begins with a murdering, brutal, cruel spirit. It begins with a diabolic mind. A mind that is devious and devilish and wicked. That it damns the instructions of Yah. It resists with every fiber, with all of its strength. There is a union with the power of hell, HaShatan. It speaks out of the bosom of HaShatan. You must prove that, man. I will. I will prove it in the book. You're speaking by speculation. No, I'm speaking by revelation of truth, not speculation. We must shofar the manna. And the manna, a number that is signed. Even at birth, in this nation, we are assigned a number. My birth, no, you were born on that day. You can never be birthed again. But my birthday or my anniversary, no, you got married on that day. You can never do that again. And so everything in this nation and the nations of the world, it is dealt upon a numeric system, dealt upon numbers. We are numbered, even our babies, with social security cards. I'm showing you the emphasis of that. No, that is not the mark of the beast. It is not the mark of the beast. I said emphatically, it is not. Yah says that we must understand, we must understand this mana, the number. It is what Yah has assigned. He brought man to the sixth day. That's what Kayan in his generation of his offspring, they were cut off at the sixth generation. You cannot show me nowhere in Torah whereby you see the lineage of Kayan spoken of in the Torah of Yah. But yet the spirit and the zira of that, it has permeated into the fibers of Yah's creation. And it is the mark of man, that is the seal of man. It is a murdering, vile, wicked, sadistic, diabolical mindset that defies Yah. And that it hates Yah with all purpose and all intent. And they despise one that stands upright. Stands for his imat. That is the truth, Yisrael. I'm going to declare it today, all right? He said, this is the mana which Yah has assigned to the beasts, to this vile behemoth, the power of every entity. Whether it was the Roman, the Medo-Persian, the Mizraim, every power, they were all numbered as Yah gave Yisrael a precise number of years to be under that oppression. It is vital to understand that, what oppression is. We deal with certain things that we don't understand the significance as to what the Ketve speaks on that. And the reason we don't, because there's not this appetite, this ferocious appetite to understand the beauty of Torah. We do not gravitate to that. And so when a man speaks above the level of our mindset and our wisdom, we tend to question that. And that's why we question it, because if I say to this child, you cannot have it, she responds, why? If I show her I can do the ABCs better than her, she will say, no, let me show you. I know. If I show her I can count farther than she can, she'll say, no, let me count. That is the mindset of we as the children of Almighty Yah. So we tend to base things on the concept that have been developed in a mind that has not matured above the level whereby we can understand revelation, where we can understand the realness of Torah. And so we question those that Yah has poured out a wisdom in. We question them according to our little understanding of the nature of the matter of things. And it cannot be. Did not they question Yahshua? Was he not the Torah of Yah? Was he not the living power of Yah? Were not these scholarly men? Were not these scholarly men? They were the Pharisaic and the Sadducee order. Were they not men that were knowledgeable of the Torah? Were they not men that embraced Torah and they were interpreters and they wrote from the writings of the Torah, and yet they could not understand the revelation of a profound truth? So they questioned him according to their intellectual ability, which was not based upon a damn thing. It was invaluable. It was worthless. And so we as a nation of people, we tend to question because of our understanding of things, of the matter. We do not have the complete wisdom. That thing has not been made tamim. It has not been made perfect in us. And that's how we question according to those lines of thoughts. That's what we question Yah. And they question Yahshua the same way, just like Yisrael questioned Yah. Did they question Moshe? Have you brought us out to destroy us? They had not experienced Yah like Moshe. They had not gone into the high place of Yah. And our minds do not gravitate to the high things of Yah. And that's the truth. That is not to belittle us. It's just to show us our place. You don't belittle your children. You show them their place. This is your place. You have not walked in my shoes. You have not gone my way. And so Yah is letting us know, you have not walked in the shoes of my son. I don't give that to every man. Hallelujah. He says that it is the mana, it is what is assigned, and it is appointed. We appointed to die, and then after the judgment. We don't understand that the word mana means mana, mana. It is appoint, an appointment. And so the average student will just look at the word Nama. He doesn't realize that the other attributes that associate with that, that you must understand that in order to understand the number. See, that in itself is 2 or 3 years of just teaching to explain that to us, that our minds can grasp that. Who knows, I will begin there next. It says his number, it is the number, it is what assigned it, it is the mana of beast and ish man. For his number is 666, 666. It is the mark of man and it is the mark of beast. It is one thing about the lion, it is a tactician. And the lioness, it is brutal. It doesn't care for the prey. It has one objective. It is not omnivore, it is carnivore. It eats only meat. And he is a proven tactician. And he stalks as the enemy goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And the beast of hell does not expose himself that you may identify him. But Yah says, if you have any wisdom or any concept of me, it is defined in this manner. Because Yah knew the end from the beginning. And we are in the Acharit. We in Yom Acharit, we're in the end time. And there is a message that is so profound that must be preached and taught. Is it in the book? Sure it is. Above all things, that truth must be revealed unto Yisrael. And it begins here. As I said, I will not get to that point today, but I will on next Shabbat. Is there a pattern, a tasnuth, and according to Torah, whereby we can examine this mind, that we can know the operation of this mind, we can see the power of this mind, we can see the attitude of this mark, of this mind. Is it in the book, or has Yah left us out in the rain? Has he given us a conclusive state of this matter, that there's a testimony of this nature? Because if it's not, then this doesn't mean a damn thing. It has no value. I'm bold enough in my own conscience of what is right before Yah to say it that way. I have no fear of death or dying because I said it that way. It's either my Abba is standing with me or he is against me today. It's either I will, by the power of subtlety, this diabolic nature, subdue you and seduce you, to turn your mind away from Yah, or cause your love to gravitate with great urgency and great passion of desire to understand. It's either that this mark of this diabolic scheme of hell, there must be a pattern of it in the Torah. It must be vividly expressed to Yisrael that we can see. Can we find one here? Let us begin a journey here then. And if I'm wrong in this assessment, I will step away today and preach not again. If this, what we will begin, will not show us what Yahweh saw, he's dealing with kingdoms and powers and rulers and spiritual beings and kings and rulers of nations and governments, then what I've said over all these years is not worth a damn thing. It has no value. And I will place it all on the line for this today. Let us begin the journey. Here in the book of Yeshaya, Isaiah, chapter 14. It is amazing, Yisrael. We began here in Yeshaya, Isaiah 14. And one of the most prophetic utterance in the writing of the Chidve is in Giliana chapter 14. You think this is coincidental that it is the mana, it has been appointed, it has been marked, and I will show us that in the time to come. Hallelujah. Yah begins here in Yeshua, Isaiah chapter 14, verse 1. He says, for Yah, I want us to understand he will have rachan. Yah will have or show his tender mercies, his kindness. And this racham is only the mercies of Yah. He will have compassion, he says, not on the nations of the earth. He says on Jacob. He's going to show his compassion upon Yisrael. He will have compassion upon his Bahir. Those that he has chosen, he has elected. Yah will have compassion, his raham upon Jacob. This is vital to understand. He is Yah that changed not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob, you have not been consumed by the vicious fire of Yah's wrath, his anger, his indignation, his fury. He's going to show compassion. He's going to show his raham. And his raham is not like our mercy. That's why we intrigue Yah for his raham, for his hasid, his kindness. He said, I'm going to show that upon Jacob, the supplanter. He says, and will yet, bochar, I will choose. He is my elect. He is the one that I have chosen. He is the one that is in my bosom. I am the one that decides for him. I am the one that chart the course for Yisrael. I'm the one that opens up the revelation unto Yisrael. He says, I will bochar. I will choose Yisrael. He will choose the nation. He is not going to choose Hashaltan. He's not going to choose the children of darkness. He's going to choose Yisrael. And this is there's a power that is virable, because the powers of hell know that. Know that there is an elect, then that one must be totally eviscerated. It must be destroyed. There can be no remembrance of the Most High. As well as the conscious thing of oppression and a thing that deals with our mind, I will show us Yisrael. If you all just bear with me and have patience, just be patient. Don't get hungry. Just wait on Yah. Hallelujah. He says, I will yet choose Yisrael. And he says, I will yanach, I will set. He will cause Yisrael to be settled in the Torah. He will settle them down. He will place them in the land which represents his erech, represents his promises to a people, or in the earth realm, in the earthly vessel. And we are earthen vessels, Yisrael. He will cause us to lie down and to have a Shabbaton. He will cause us to remain. And that is that we remain in the Dabar, the promises of Almighty Yah. We shall abide there. He is prefacing this to let us know that there is an opposition that is so diabolic. It is the mark of man and beast. It is ferocious. It has no compassion at all. So he's letting us know, I'm going to show compassion on you. I don't want you to think that what you're encountering is strange. It is the powers trying to prevail, to place the mark or the sign or the oath of man, that you operate as a man, but you to operate beyond the sphere of a man. I don't want you to operate in the beastly conscience. I want you to let the mind of your sure, a Torah driven, a mind that delights in Torah, a mind that loves Yah. Not with your damn verbiage of expression, your false verbiage, I love him. It's a mind of action. It's a mind of faithfulness. It's a mind of omen, faithful, with confidence. A mind of assurance and steadfast, unshakable, unmovable. It's a mind that always abides and abounds in the nutrients and the nurturing of the Torah of Yah. So he prophesies, he gives us confidence in him. You may think it's strange, but I have confidence in me. He wants us to have confidence that even as the revelation of matters began to be revealed, that we're not so soon shaken. We don't run toward the beast. We don't run toward this mind for comforting or covering. He is our covering, Yisrael. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He's going to set us in our own land, not in the land of the oppressors, in our own land. And then he says that the gear of the strangers shall be joined. If he's going to set us in our own land, then why should there be strangers joining us? I will show us that, Yisrael, because the nations have abused the very heritage of Yah. They have brought them down to the shackles of darkness. They have brought us down to the shackles of depravity and labor that was so intense and brutal that the oppression is still in the minds of the DNA of the heritage of that people today. He said, I'm going to allow the strangers to join you. Did he not allow that when he brought them out of Mizraim? Were there not a mixed multitude? And the mixed multitude caused them to begin to murmur and to complain. You cannot mix the Torah of Yah with this vile thing you call Christendom. You cannot mix the Torah of Yah with this thing. Yes, we are nationalists for the kingdom of Yah, but this nationalist fleshly identity is not worth a damn thing. It has no value at all, Yisrael. All flesh is as grass. Not some. It is all. It is putrefied. It stinks. It has no damn value at all. It all dies. The skin worm eats it all. It is all corrupt. For as me in my flesh, my bazaar that dwelleth, no tough thing. The commandments of Yah does not dwell in a natural carnal mind. It must be a spiritual mind. And the only way the mind is spiritual, you must have the revelation of the power of the testimony of Yahshua. That's why those that deny Yahshua, they call themselves Hebrews. They're as false and wicked as hell. They're trying to carry out the acts of Yah by a natural proclivity. And you don't have the ability. We must operate in the living power of his Torah. That it excites us when we hear the name of Yahshua. It promotes the very nature of Yah. Hallelujah. I'm not afraid to stand and to say that, Yisrael. It was one lying bastard that was here with us. They said, I rejected the name of Yahshua. He's a damn dirty beast. And he's suffering for that even now. His life is dismal. He's a wicked child of hell. And everything that he places damn wicked hands on, it is a curse that there's a chala. It produced nothing at all, Yisrael. That's why don't allow these bastards to lay hands suddenly on you. Don't allow these bastards to embrace you. I will not. You can. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. I'm not intimidated. I'm not fearful of their actions against me. I don't give a damn what they speak against me. They speak against Yah.
That will get us all quiet.
He said, and the gear, the stranger shall be joined with them. He says, and they shall cleave. They shall be attached, Yisrael, to Beit Yaakov. Yah is simply saying that you're going to see my hand among the nations. And I'm going to bring all Yisrael to the Erech, the land, to the bosom of Yahshua HaMashiach. We cannot return, we cannot embrace what we call Yisrael until we embrace the earthen vessel that brought forth. Did not the riches of Yah come out of that earthly vessel? Did not the very nature of Hashatan come out of that earthen vessel in Cain? Did it not, Yisrael? Sure did. And we must gather ourselves in Yerushalayim, the city of Yahshalom. It is the birthplace, it is the mind of Yahshua. And we must gather there, Yisrael. We can't gather outside of the perimeters. That's why Yah said he's going to even allow the gift, the strangers, those that are unattached unto Beit Yisrael. They have a purpose in the kingdom. And that's the truth. I shall proceed. You're not answering Juliana. I shall if you just stay with me. In verse 2 of the same chapter. And the people, the Goim, the nations, shall take them and bring them to their place. For what reason? And Beit Yisrael shall nachal. They shall possess. They're going to take the nations as a heritage. That's what they're going to do. Can I stop there for a moment? Because I want to pick this up and read just something. Yah says that they're going to gather the nations, that Yisrael will take the nations for a heritage, a nachal. Now the enemy knows that. He understands what the heritage of Yah shall receive. That's why he utters here in the book of Lucas. Luke, we're going to go back to Yeshaya. But I want to read this out of the book of Lucas. It is important. Hallelujah. Out of the book of Lucas, here in chapter 4. And I want to read one verse. Let me read it out of the book of Matithiah. It is more clarified here in the book of Matithiah. Chapter 4. Matithiah chapter 4. And one verse here I want to read. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says here in the book of Matithiah, Matthew, chapter 4, verse 8. It says, again, Hashotzan, he takes Yahshua HaMashiach into an exceedingly high mountain. And we think that these things do not have credence. We're wrong. It's because we do not labor enough in the Torah to understand these things. And we just omit words. They do not register in our mind. That's what we must have, the mind of Yahshua. He takes him into a high mountain, and he said, and he showed him all. Did he not say? Yah says here in Yeshaya, and the people, the nation, shall take them, the strangers, and bring them to their place. And Beit Yisrael shall possess them in the land of Yah for servants and shifcha, or handmaidens. They're going to possess them, and they shall take them captive, Sheba, whose captive they were. Those that have enslaved Yisrael, they shall be brought into captivities, and all the nations of the earth have enslaved the nation of Yisrael. And those that have, they're going to be brought under the same servitude that they have been compelled, oppressed, to serve. That's what he says. So the enemy understands this. Do you know how he knows this? Because it is written. And he knows that it is written. Through his scholaristic approach, he has searched the Torah of Yah. And it says here that he take Yahshua into the high mountain, into the Ha, and he showed him all the melchut of the kingdoms of the world, and he showed him the honor and the beauty of them. Verse 9 is the key. And he said to him, all these things will I give you. Yah says, I'm going to give Yisrael the kingdom. I'm going to give Yisrael the kingdom. I'm going to give him the kingdoms of the earth. And Hashotan says to Yahshua, he showed him all the mighty kingdoms and the magnificent power of the kingdoms. And he said, all of this, the power, the beauty,
the ecstasy, the charm, the lavishness. And that's what he has done to his damn wicked children. When you take six people, like the Waltons, six children that owns more wealth than 90 million people in America, he has a elect, just like Yah has a chosen one. The man had no unique skills, no beauty, and his children are birthed out of the darkness of hell. He showed him all the kingdoms. He showed him all the splendor of his creation in the mind of man that has objected or turned away from Yah. So he showed him all those kingdoms in a moment of time. He says, and he said unto him, all these things will I give you if you will fall down and worship me. You must bow. You must give credence unto me. You must shechach. You must. It is the mark, the oath of man. Six, a mind that is depraved, that has rejected the counsel of Yah, and the beast that runs as though that in its erratic way, that there is no conscience, there is no thought of that beast's mind, and it destroys everything in its path. And it is the power of a government of that spirit that cause everything that comes from your loins to be corrupt. Nothing pure can come out. That's why I'm appalled at these dirty bastards. They say they love their children and do not train them up in the mastery of the Torah of Yah. They're dirty bastards. I don't give a damn who they are. I don't give a damn. They have no love. They have no love. They don't know the love of Yah. If any man says he loves Yah, he loves Yahshua and keeps not his mitzvah, he's a liar. And the Torah is not in him. I don't care who it is. I don't care how much you love them. I don't know how much you are inspired by their obedience and their beauty. It doesn't mean a damn thing to Yah. He cannot lie. He cannot lie. Yah says, they shall all be brought into that land that I shall give them. And he said, and they shall rada. They're going to rule. They're going to dominate. In the book of Yeshaya, he said, they're going to dominate over their oppressor. I want you to remember that word there, nagas, oppressor. Those that exert, and the mind that exert the ultimate to destroy any fiber of any kind of promise of tikva, hope in anything outside of that realm. He said that he's going to rule over of his nagas, his oppressors, those that oppress. And we're living in a nation that oppresses. We're living in a nation that robs and destroys 400 people, own more wealth, 400 than 6 billion, 600 million, 500 million people plus. You got 400 people that controls 3/4 of the earth's wealth. That is oppressive, and it leaves us 6 billion, 500 million plus to fight for that. You tell me that's the hand of Yah. HaShatan says, I will form this conscience and this mind that will spew out the most diabolic, venerable diseases upon the mind of the nation. I want to infest the mind of Yisrael. I want to corrupt their seed. I want to pollute it. It is one thing that a corrupt seed can produce nothing at all. You cannot put a corrupt seed in the ground and think that you're going to get some fruit from that seed. And so his mission is to corrupt every seed. He doesn't give a damn about killing his own. He's trying to corrupt the Zirah of Yisrael. So he has given the wealth of the earth unto those because the earth is in the command of the wicked. Is either so or Jacob told a damn lie. He did not lie. He has given the earth over into the hands of the Rasha, criminals and wicked people, because we as a nation, we reject him. We determine our own laws and our own rights. We have determined what is just and what is unjust before Yah. And he is not going to allow us to do that. So he give us comfort to let us know, I know you're oppressed. I know you're subject, but I'm going to remove you. And I'm going to put you in a land and settle you there. I'm going to settle you in the bosom of Yahshua HaMashiach until you learn how to dance. In him we live and we move and we have our being. In Yah we live. We live in Yahshua. Because Yahshua lives, we can face every opposition. Hallelujah. I want you to understand that in Yah's kingdom, HaShatan said, I will give you rule over my kingdom. But in the kingdom of Yah, Yisrael is going to rule over every nation in the Melchut. And the enemy is trying to do all he can to derail that. And Yah says, his wisdom, you must understand the mindset of man. You can see with Kayan. You must understand the mindset of the subtlety and the diabolic nature of HaShatan. You must understand the rule of his government and the power of his government to rule. You must understand that. It is about this religious factor. And that's why all of these damnable religions aren't worth a damn. I don't give a damn if Judaism. I don't give a damn if it's Islam, Hinduism, Christianity. It's not worth a damn. There's only one truth. And it is all revealed through Yahshua HaMashiach. Yes, you can call him a man, for man indeed he was. But he was the son of the man of war. And Yah calls himself a man too, doesn't he? That's why he poured out in man something. And he put in nothing else. Not even the Melechim. And that's the truth, Yisrael. Hallelujah. 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 Verse 3. Yah said, and it shall come to pass in that day when Yah shall give you rest. He said, I'm going to bring down the opposition of hell. He's going to give us a rest, comfort, where we can settle and truly rest. He said, I'm going to bring down the power of Bevel. I'm going to bring down the power of that mind, that conscience. That I'm going to bring it down to the grave of darkness. Yah says, I will give you rest, nuach, from your sorrows and from all of your fears, your yare, your fears, your doubts, and from all of your heart, your kaseth, your intense burdensome labor, your fierce, intense bondage in which you were made to serve others. Yisrael has been made to serve. We have been compelled to serve. We had no jurisdictions over that. Yah has given us and place a nation into the hands of the most virile and vileless of people. That he will show the excellence of his power. The revelation of Yahshua. The realness of his kingdom. That we rejoice and dance exceedingly. And there's a kingdom that has been risen up at the gates of hell. That defies and tries to destroy the beauty of the elements of Yah's kingdom. And it begins in the labah of man. It begins in an express. It is our briars. That is important why the mark shall be here and his hand. I will show that in the teachings to come. I will point it all out. No, I'm not an expert. I'm not an expert. I am just one that seeks, and I lay my love to seek with everything that Yah muster in me. And when you seek with all of your heart, you shall find. When you labor in the Torah, you will find it. It will be revealed to you. You're not going to read it and find it. You must labor. You must sit and agonize and travail. Did Yahshua agonize in the garden? Did he travail in the garden? Was it revealed unto him? Did he not say, nevertheless, what pleases me, what pleases you? Yes. It pleases Yah to reveal unto us the mysteries of the magnificent wisdom of his power, Yisrael. Yes. It gives him great delight that he trusts us with that. He did not create us and set us apart not to trust us with his wisdom. He did it. And the vile nature of hell tell us, don't trust nobody. Don't trust us. No. Yes. That's not what he meant. Did he give them Moshe? Did he intend for them to trust him? Did he give them Obadiah? Did he intend for them to trust them? Did he give them Tisaphaniah? Did he give them Nehemiah? Did he give Yisrael Yeshaya? Yes, did he give them Abraham. And out of all of Israel, the nature of man of that seed is always trying to supplant. That's why he is known as Jacob, the supplanter. He is always trying to supplant the order of Yah. Isn't that what he did? Isn't that what Jacob did? He tried to supplant. Did he not do that? Isn't the nature of man always trying to supplant Yah? When Yah speaks unto us, just as that simple, and Chadosh, Chadosh, and we are saying that it's lunar. He says nowhere in the book it's lunar. Nowhere in the writings. I don't give a damn about the interpretation of men, what they have interpreted. I believe what is written in the writing of the book. And every translation, there is nowhere where he says, remember the lunar Shabbat. He gave them a law that was so simple that even when they look at it, they will be ashamed of their nature because it is not complex to keep. It is not complex to God that. And he needed or instilled that in the mind of man. He has not lost it one bit, his body, his old conscience. There's something in man that caused him. And those that were of the offsprings, they remembered. And they taught their children to teach their children, children. And their children, children, children. And their children, children, children. And we are the children of the children of the children of the forefathers. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just don't write me any kind of way, all right? Unless you're ready to battle. Hallelujah. Can I move on? Hallelujah. Verse 4. He said that I want you to take up this mashal, this mishnah, this proverb. He said, I want you to take up this proverb, this speech, this message. He identifies one as the melech, the king. Of Babel. What is the Melech? He is there to guard the heritage of the people. Isn't he? Sure he is. That's what the Melech was for. Not to oppress, overtax, overburden. The Melech is there to guard the heritage of the people. Is Yahshua not our king? Was he not set to guard the heritage of Israel for Yah's people? And he has a watchman by the name of Micaiah, the Melech, or the Achmelech, to guard Israel. He fights for Israel. He is the king. He is the king. He is the living power of Yah, his word, that is alive. And it was meant to be alive in us. Just like the words of Ashratan. He said, I want you to take up this mashal against now for the king. He says, saying, listen now, how has the, as they call him an oppressor, the oppressor, the nagaz, those that exact and those that press upon the nature of the mind, how has the oppressor ceased? How has he stopped? And the golden city ceased, the riches of the city, your kingdom, your government. How has it ceased? We must understand the nature of the mark of man and the beast. It is one of oppression. It is the ultimate institution of Hashatan. How do I know? I know there are those that if they don't see it in the renewed covenant, they don't believe it. I want you to direct your attention here in the book of Acts, in the book of the book of Acts. We're going to continue out of Yeshaya. The book of Acts, chapter 10, verse 38. And when Kepha opened his mouth to speak unto the remnant, the scattered, he says here in the book of Acts 10:38, how Yah anointed Yeshua of Nazareth with the Ruach HaKodesh. And he gave him koach, power and might to demonstrate his Torah. Who went about doing tov. And he went about healing all that were blessed or oppressed. All those that were nagas. He went about healing all those that were nagas. of the devil. Does it say that in your writing? Does it say that? We go back to Yeshua. It says, how in verse 4, how has the Nagas, the oppressor. We know that that is one of the most powerful natures of this mind of the mark of the beast. It is one that oppress. Has this nation oppressed? Has this nation exact? Has the government of this nation, was it not established on oppressing, murdering, and killing? When there are overthrows of government, are they not based upon oppression and killing? This is the very seed of Hashatan. It is the nature of Hashatan. And you are sure, what about healing all those? As the mouth of Kefa'aret unto Yisra'yah, healing all those that were Nagas, oppressed Yisra'yah. It is one thing that the mind of man does, and that is what Hashatan must get in the heart of man. That's why these bastards that we know as the Waltons, they can oppress those that labor for them. They can pay them pittance, and they will own all the wealth. They are dirty children of hell. They are the beasts born out of the depths of the darkness of the belly of hell. They are children created in the image and the mind of Hashatan. Just like this government that they call a capitalist, it is to capitalize and to bring in the captivity and to bring in the bondage. And yet the liberty of the Yah is to bring the freedom unto Yisrael according to the dictions and the writings of the Torah. He went about healing all those that were oppressed, Nagas, by the devil, by devils. By the Shodim, the Shat, by Hashatan, all of those, you understand. Wasn't that what Cain tried to do to oppress Habel, to shut his mouth, and he murdered him? That zero, that seed, is one of murdering. It kills and it oppresses. It destroys. It is a mine that is void of the conscience of Yah. It is a mind that has no cognate value of the principles of Yah. It has a form. It looks nice, but it denies the power thereof. Why? Because that mind cannot live. It cannot abide in Torah. It cannot rest. It has no nuach in Torah truth, Yisra'yah. It operates outside of the parameter of that. Everyone is oppressed today. The jobs oppress them. The food we eat cause oppression. And everything, Yisra'yah. That's a fact. He has corrupted everything. Everything he touches. Everything the man touches, he corrupts it. He touches the seeds, he corrupts them. He touches the seeds that try to alter them and change. You intend for there to be pests to eat at our crops and things. He intend for us to inquire and to seek him and to grow in a way that is pleasing unto him. Let the land rest. Yeah. That's why he gives us a time of rest. Why every 7 years you let it rest. In Yah's time, the order of his time has not changed. Hallelujah. I'm going to preach today. Whether you understand or not, I'm going to preach. Listen to it again and again and again and again. You watch soap operas over and over and again, listen to this again and again and again. You watch the same damn comedy every Wednesday or every Thursday again and again and again. You watch the reruns again and again and again. The enemy is polluting the minds of your babies, and you set them before some of the most wicked obstacles. And you don't give a damn. You say you love them. You don't give a damn. You're not a mother. That's the spirit of a Jezebel. You feed them with damn corrupt. You think you're right. You're not right. Man, you're a damn fool. You feed your baby asinine. You feed your baby cyanide. You feed yourself that. Because you're dead in trespasses of your sin. You don't give a damn about them. You train them. I'm going to teach on that soon, all right? I got some messages on Khatfe Imat. He will teach. I will teach. I will teach some things, all right? Well, I will get the other stuff in. Don't worry about that. They will assist me, okay? Moving quickly. Hallelujah. 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 I will read that again in the book of Acts 10:30. How Yah anointed Yahshua Nazareth with the Ruach HaKodesh, with power, and he went about doing Tav. And look at that. It did not, see, this is the first thing he identifies. He went about doing the excellence of Yah's Torah. But then he went about Rapha, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Why that? That's why he says, speak the Mashal against the Melech of Bavel. Who is this man? It is the mark of man and beast, isn't it? And the city that oppress and exact oppression upon them. How have you fallen? How has your government been brought down? How has it been crushed? There was no power that could rise up against you to do it. America is what they call the superpower, isn't she? So super mean that there is nothing that equates to you in your power, your military might, your strength. There's nothing else. She is known as a superpower. Her economy is super. Her economy is resilient. Her people are resilient, as they say, don't they? All the politicians say that. That we are resilient people. We are people that make a way out of nothing. That's what they say. The spirit of oppression is vital to understand. That is what Cain tried to do, suppress the voice of Hebel from crying. And Yah says, as the Nobi says, Yesha, that until the Zira of Kaya be removed from off the face of the earth, that cry will continue. And everyone wants to focus on Esav. Hallelujah. We're dealing with the mark of the beast, its inception, when it was conceived in the heart. Because it was already there in the heart of Hashatan. He was a liar and a murderer from the beginning because he did not abide in truth. And when the time, the appointed time came to offer the offering, that's where you have these liars saying you don't have to keep more of them. You don't have to keep the feast days. They're dirty bastards. They're saying that you can labor on the Shabbat, not so. You can work. It is a cursed thing. It is a cursed thing. It's a different one of man. It's ignorant. He doesn't know. And so what time Yah winked at our ignorance? But with a man, it would have been better for the man never to have laid his hand to the plow, to have not understand the sadiq of that, than to lay his hand to the plow and turn his damn wicked heart back. He's not even fit for the kingdom. I don't give a damn if it's your son. I don't give a damn if it's your daughter, your husband, your wife. It doesn't mean a damn thing to Yah. We have weak men today. I understand why the women are weak. But when you find a virtuous woman, a woman that is high yield, she walks in the strength of the beauty of Torah. And her walk is so beautiful, she abides in the ways of Yah. Even when she has a husband that's a damn fool, he will not interfere with that. When she truly walks in that. When she is as fictitious as him, when she will do the same things he will do, knowing it's against Yah, then he has no confidence in her. And that's why there are many of women that have lost what they thought they had, a damn husband. They had a boy. You understand? We must be sold out for Yah. We must be real, Yisrael. And that's a fact. That's a fact. I'm not going to coddle us. Yah have tried to do it and it doesn't even work. We don't give a damn. So if we don't allow Yah to coddle us, you think you're going to allow me to coddle you? We're not going to allow it. Let me move on. Is that all right? This is the nature of this oppressor. Yeshaya 14:6. Yah says, he who smote, you have nakai. You have smote. Did not Kayan smite Nacha? Did he not smite Hebel? Did he kill him? You have smote the people in your Ebra, in your wrath, your outpouring, the overflowing of your wickedness. Your arrogance, he said, with a continuous stroke, a macha. You have not alleviated the stroke. You have continued to strike and to beat them. You wound them. He that rules the nations. Now, it is the ruler now. We must understand. Remember now, it is the number. We that have wisdom. It is the number of a man and beast. He that rules the nations in anger is persecuted and none hinder. You that was the ruler and you rule the people with your Ebra. Now, he says, take up the Mishra against Bavel. And now there is none that hinders. One of his nature is one of smiting. We see that in the beginning, don't we? One of the most profound, egregious acts of one of the most blatant, violent attempts to destroy Yah's Torah is found in the book of Matithiah. Hallelujah. When Yahshua is betrayed. We're dealing with that one word here. We're dealing with the word nacha, to smite, to beat. Here in the book of Matithiah, Matthew 26, verse 67. Then they, when Yahshua betrayed, those that were the ministers of the Torah, then they, Kohan, they spit in his face. They spit the spittle in the face of Yahshua. And they buffet him, they beat him. And it says, and others did what? Others did what? They smote him. It is the nature of the mark of man, the beast, and this government. It is to smite Yisra'el. And they smote him with the palm of their hand. It says again in Yeshaya 14:6, and he nakah the people in wrath, Ebra. Do we need not see the manifestation of the Ebra in the heart of the people of the Kohan? Those that were the keepers, the preservers of the Torah. We find that today, and they smote him, they beat him with his hand. Are they not doing that today? The yad represents the strength and the nature of man. That is what the yad represents, the hand. It represents his power. It represents his government. It represents his authority, his might. That's what the yad represents. And the brow is in the head, where the mark shall be, here or here. It represents the conscious, the mind, the expression of man. And that's the first thing that y'all noticed in Kayan, that his conscience was disfigured. I've watched the dirty beast in my presence. And that's the first place I look right in here, because I know that. I know the mark of man. The mark of man is the mind that resists Yah. And the first thing it does, it smites at Yah. They will hit at you with their ipra, their anger, their hostility. You're not dealing with the schoolboy here. This doesn't come by sitting on your ass, Yisra'el. And they smote Yahshua. Did that? Does the Torah says that? They beat him in his face, and verse 30, and they spit on him. And then they took the reed. Look what they did. They took the reed. They took the reed. They took the reed, and they smote. I'm sorry, Matithiah 27, quickly. Matithiah 27:30. Same account. It says, Matithiah chapter 27, verse 30, and they spit upon him, and they took the reed that was the thorns that they impregnated in his mind. That's what the enemy did. That's why the one that saw the top seed, there's one that came behind and saw the tares. And when the soul of the tough seeds went forth, he sowed the seeds. When it fell among the thorns and the rocky places of thorn, they grew up and they choked out the word, didn't it? And that's what this reed represents, to choke out the life of Yah, the visibility of Yah among Yisra'el. That's why our minds oppress, and the enemy oppress our minds, Yisra'el. Matithiah 27:30, and they spit on him. And they took the reed and they smote him on the head. They beat Yahshua on his head, Yisra'el. That's what the oppressor, the mark of man and beast. And this king of Babel, he was one that oppressed. He was one that smote the people with a continuous stroke. You think that they just tapped him like that? The ebra, the anger, the wrath, the hostility was so vile and so uncontrollable, so wicked. They rage, they saliva, they spit, and spit on him as the stench of their vile dripped from that body. We're a nation that spit in the face of Yah. They spat on him and they beat him and smote him. Zakin Yaramaya brought his body was much more than any man. The contusions in his face. No, he didn't have this little damn effeminate faggot face that you see on these damn wicked lying pictures, you see. His countenance was disfigured. And they didn't slap him like that with their fists. Bastards spitting on him and this raging beast, everybody trying to get to him. But it pleased Almighty Yah that he suffered that. So does it please him that we suffer? He said, my pleasure. Because I'm going to make known my name and my government shall stand against the wiles of hell. My kingdom shall not be blotted out. I've entrusted that in the bosom of man. That's why this nation and the world is teaching us to hate man, to not trust man. We would hear Zakin Yeshai, he talks about how he trusts his daddy. He trusts him. And that's what the enemy is getting us to do, not to trust and to have this distrust. Yisrael, oh, I don't trust him because you don't trust you. You can't do me no harm whether you do me wrong. You haven't done me harm. What have you done to me? You took me for $50, $100. I don't have no money for you to take me for anything like that. What have you taken me for? So what? What is that? I remember one of the young men that we have said to him when they say, so what if someone takes me for $1,005? What is that? You haven't taken anything. What is that? You haven't taken the measure of his beauty, his strength from my bosom. So that doesn't mean a damn thing, man. Not at all. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says in verse 7, chapter 14 of Yeshaya, verse 7, it says that the ho'olam, he said that the earth is at nu'ach, at rest. When this power is brought under subjection of the Torah of Yah, then we rest, Yisrael. The whole earth rests, and it is quiet. And then they began to break forth in singing. When that oppression began to fall, don't you break forth in singing? Don't you begin to rejoice when you're delivered from the shackles of that? He said, the whole earth break forth singing. And then he instructs us. He said, yes, even the fir tree, the mighty ones, the strong ones, the messengers, those that told the line, the fir trees rejoice. And even the cedar of Lebanon saying, since you have laid down, no woodcutter is come up against us. Since Yah has brought down this powerful entity of hell, no one has come to destroy and to rape our forests and to rape our minds. Since you have brought down the diabolical institutions of darkness, then there is nothing to try to institute in my mind a conscience to fight against you, Yah. That is what this verse represents. Since Yah has brought who down? He's going to have to bring this kingdom. That's why he says, I'm going to mark it. Don't put your damn hands on it. Man, don't even touch it. It's mine. I just want us to have wisdom that we know who that is. I want you to have understanding that you know that I placed the mark there. You will see it upon them. You will have a spiritual eye that see it when the world doesn't see it at all, Yisrael. You literally think that the people with these scanners, they're going to walk and put their head. You think that's the mark of the beast, You think that Yah will give that to the wicked to understand that it is a mystery, it's a revealer to the Nabi, the messengers of Yah. You by that damn comical mess. I will, come on, man. Every man, he will cause everyone, rich, poor, small, and great, to receive the mark of the beast. So you think that they're going to turn around the world in the most desolate places, they take a mark. Oh, they're going to have a mark, but it's greater than that. I will bring that out. How about that? I'm trying to lay the foundation, so we got to tear down all these old crazy pillars and tear down this mess in us that we've allowed to build up. All right. I will show us, Yisrael. Hallelujah. I will show you the simplicity of it. Oh, it is a very argent task, but the simplicity is revealed. Through all of the labor. Hallelujah. This is what Yah says here in Yeshaya 14:9. He says unto the serpent of hell, he says unto this melech, this man, how do I know it's a man? I will prove it. It is the mark of a man and the mark of a beast. And every government is represented by beasts, isn't it? Look at America. Is it not represented by one of the most ferocious beasts of the air, the eagle? Look at Russia, the bear. Look at China, the dragon. Look at all the nations. Look at Britain. Look at France. All of them are represented by beasts. They're not represented by a beast like a cattle. They're not represented by beasts like that. They're beast nations. And the spirit of those nations, it is beasts. The rush, a bear would tear down anything. Don't mess. I have read that is one of the most ferocious beasts of all beasts. If you try to interfere with a cub, it will kill, it will tear down everything. It will tear it up. I've never encountered one, don't want to encounter one. And I'm not going out in the woods looking for one to be quiet and sneaking up on a bear. If I saw one, I'm running. I'm not climbing no tree because I know that he can scale the tree so far. I'm running to a vehicle because I'm not going in any proximity where I'm going to be a mile from a bear and I got to run a mile. I may go a few feet. And when I see him, there he is. Get in the car, lock the doors, turn it on. So when he gets close, we're going to move on. I'm not a fool. I don't interfere with the nature of a beast that's his domain. That is damn stupidity. I'm not going in the ocean trying to feed a shark. I'm not doing that. I'm not going to the jungle and trying to walk up on a lion and say, kitty, kitty, kitty. Yeah? And he says, yum, 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 you bigger than what you're offering me. Those are tidbits. I want some of you, man. I will, man. Hallelujah. I want to press through this today, all right? Let me get through this part. I don't know if I will, but I'm going to put everything in it to get through this part because I know I'm loquacious. And the reason I talk so much is because I want you to get every finite detail. You understand? Hallelujah. It says in Isaiah 14:9, he says, hail from beneath, and that is Sheol. There are those that are this vile thing, Jehovah Witnesses, and those that say that hell is not what it has been played out to be. That's a lie. Sheol is just not only the grave of the earth, but it is the underworld. There's a world there. And that is what Sheol is. It is an underworld. It is the world that is real as this world. It is the world of darkness. Well, the grave, you go to the grave and that's it. And that's it, your body. No, Yah says hell. He says there's a physical force that hell from beneath. It has been ragaz. It trembles. It is awakened. It waits. Hell from beneath. It quakes in rage, waiting with agitation upon anticipation for the prize that Yah has numbered and marked for it to repay. Hell is excited. It groans. It has a taste and it awakens. He said, hell has moved. For what? To meet you at your coming. You're going to hell, he's saying. He says that even hell stirs up the dead. The grave caused the dead to get up. When Yahshua went down into the grave, did the dead get up? Did they all meet? Get up out of the grave and enter into the bosom of Abraham. The Siddiq got up. They got up out of the city of Yerushalayim. That's the city of Shalom. They got up. Sure they did. They went into the bosom, the promises of Yah. Hallelujah, where the grave had held them. It said, the dead is stirred up for you. Was not the dead stirred up for Yahshua? Was he a man? Was he a man? Was he numbered with the transgressor? Is this a man here Yah is talking about? He's a man. Is hell stirred up? Did the dead, will the dead get up? What dead? Not the dead that got up with Yahshua. This is a different dead here. Cannot go around Torah of Yah. We are people that destroy because we lack knowledge. Because the enemy has taught us not to trust anyone. Don't trust no one. I've never been that way. I don't care how a man does me. I don't care how he, that does not cause me to mistrust someone else. All of them are like, no, I can't say that because I know I'm not like all. I don't do what all do. I know that. I don't give a damn what you say. Come on. I will. I know that man is not like all. I know these are not like all. Come on. I will, man. I know that. I'm not that shallow. Hallelujah. Come on, Yisra'ya. All women are dirty hoes. You're a damn liar. They're not all the same. You're not all wicked. Every woman can. No, they all don't do that. The men that acted in the depravity and the folly, but they knew and they had confidence and they had faithfulness. They trusted in the bosom of their Ishmael. Talk to me, Yisra'ya. Now tell me they all are alike. And that is the truth. Hell from beneath us stirred itself. Did hell stir itself for Yahshua? Sure it did. Were the dead stirred? Sure it was. Was he a man? Did he have a number? Sure he had a number. He made his bed with the number of the transgressors. He was appointed. His days were numbered. His time was numbered. His years were numbered. His stay in the depth of the grave were numbered. Your deals with numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. She was numbered. Hallelujah. This is a man, isn't it? He said, hell from beneath the stirred up for you to meet you at your coming. He said, even all the chief ones of the earth, the mighty ones, it has raised up, even those that have died in the transgression, it has raised up from their thrones all the Melechim of the Goim. Hallelujah. He says here in verse 22, for a fire, an ish, a fire, Yah says, is kindled in my anger. I want to show you the fire of hell now. It's kindled in the anger of Yah. It says, and shall burn to the lowest hell. Does it say that? It shall burn down to the lowest hell. No, I'm sorry. I'm getting ahead of myself. Deuteronomy 32:22. I paste these scriptures so I don't have to turn in the book, and when I get overexcited, that's all right. Turn quickly to Devarim. Here, Yah, you know, Yah says in Yeshai, hell from beneath is moved. There are those that say hell is not real. But this is what it says in the Torah here in Devarim chapter 32, verse 22. Devarim 32:22. Hell is real, Yisra'ya. Yeah? It's for the judgment of those that which have defied the Torah of Yah. It says in Devarim 32:22, Yah talks about being obedient and faithful unto me, people. Trust in me. He said, for a fire is kindled in my anger. What is the fire of Yah like? What is the fire, the ish of Yah like? The ish, what is that like? You say the same way you say man, fire, ish. You spell it different in some places, but it's still the same. I-S-H-A-E-S-H. He said, an ish, the fire, and my anger is kindled. Yah said, it shall burn to the lowest part of hell. His anger, does it say that? To the lowest parts of hell. His fire, his wrath shall burn to the lowest part of hell. He said, hell from beneath is stirred up. It is the anger of Yah. It is the anger of Yah against this kingdom mind, this privileged mindset, this nature, this attitude against Yah. He said, my anger is stirred up. And he's given us reference to his power, his anger, Yisra'ya. We don't fall short of his order as a nation, as a people. It burns to the lowest hell and shall consume the earth with her increase and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. Tell me what can set on the foundations or the foundations of the mountains on fire. It's only the wrath and the anger of Yah. You're not burning the mountains. The stones are not going to burn. Yah said, my anger shall burn down to hell. He said, I'm going to eradicate the earth of that zirah. And that's the only way you're going to eradicate the earth of that seed by fire. That's the only way. I was saying to Ak, Simeon, we got to burn garden one. To get rid of some of those seeds that will populate in the garden on next year, we got to go out there and burn it. And get down to those seeds. Because if you don't, you're going to have more than you had this year. His fire burned down to the lowest part of the earth. And hell is awakened for those that have embraced the doctrine of man, because it has been developed by the mind of Hashatan. It established a kingdom working that individual to fight against all that is pure. There are those that you mention the name of Yah and they fight against it. Those that you think they love you, your kinsmen, and they reject this name. They will call upon a damn pagan lie, a Jesus, a Jesus, a Lord, and a damn God. And they will tell you the devil's name. Sure they will. But the Most High, they will reject his name. And they're so self-righteous, and they look nice, and they pretend to be nice, but they're dirty children of hell. Their clothes are not washed. I don't give a damn what they say. I don't care how they help the poor. I don't care what they give. You can give to the poor. You can give all you want to. It doesn't mean a damn thing to Yah. His love is based upon your love for his mitzvah. If you don't love the Torah of Yah, you don't love him. I don't give a damn what you say. And that's why the enemy is taking away your time. You don't have time in the day. You don't have time to teach your children. You don't have time to spend with them because we're too busy damn eating and watching this and looking for that pecking on a damn computer and everything. We're too busy for that. We have time for the damn computer, but no time for the children. We have time for the damn television, but no time to interact and to embrace each other and to make known our love to each other. We have time for the damn Walmart, the damn Kmart, and the damn rich dogs, Walton, to make them bastards richer. But we don't have time to make ourselves rich in the power of the knowledge of Almighty Yah. We want to run and go and spend. We don't have no damn time for Yah. And he is the one that gives you breath. What a damn dismal people we are. We are wicked people. He's given us an expression here. Ours ain't taking nothing back. Not nothing. Ours ain't taking nothing back. Nothing. Give a damn about your feelings or your expression. We're dealing with our nefesh, our being. Our lives. We're around twiddling our wicked thumbs. Plan around. I'll get it right. Now will you hear the Torah of Yah, harden not your hearts as in the days of provoking Yah. Turn when you hear it. Turn. Turn when you hear it. We can't continue to make excuses. Hell has opened its doors down to the lower parts of hell. Back to Yeshaya. Well, let me read this in Yeshaya, chapter 5, verse 14, concerning hell. He speaks about the judgment of this mark of the beast. This truth must be taught, and it must be revealed in a way that, how is it that people can teach what they call salvation or the deliverance of Yah and Yahshua unto the people? But there's a message that is much more profound than that for us in this Akhirith. I will get to that. But look what it says in the book of Yeshua, chapter 5, Isaiah 5. And we will go back to Isaiah 14 and verse 10. But look what it says here in Isaiah 5, 14. Yah says, therefore, he says, hell, or the Rahab, hell, has enlarged herself. This is what hell has done. Hell has enlarged herself. Does it say that? Does it say that? She has enlarged herself and opened her mouth with measure. Without measure. She is Rahab. There's no way you can measure it. She has opened her gates without measure. And Yah says, and their beauty, and the beauty of Babel, the beast government, and those that receive the mark of the beast, and their multitude, the many, the much, and their pomp, and all of their circumstances, their beauty. When that old Jezebel over there, Queen Elizabeth, she gets out, it costs millions for that old wrinkle whore. I call her a dirty whore because it's no telling what that Jezebel of hell has done. Damn her. She's a damn Jezebel with a haughty arrogance that she doesn't even touch what she calls her subjects. The dirty whore snarl her nose at the people. You can't even embrace her. I remember when Miss Barbara Bush and that precious one of the diasporas, this big, huge woman, her skin was black as soot. And they went into her home, and because the woman was kind, she had fried chicken and all that for Miss Barbara Bush. I remember that. I saw the clip. And this slut Miss Queen, this Jezebel, that old simple black-skinned woman with the skin glycerin, when she walks into her house, she grabbed that dirty whore. She should have embraced her. Maybe would have. She could have rubbed off a little sensibility in that dirty Jezebel. Yeah, I'm talking to all of you. I don't give a damn if you're Britain or what. She's a damn dirty slut. She's part of this wicked, beastly kingdom power. She has the mind of her Shatan. When that old black woman grabbed her and embraced her, that slut of a dog, she was so petrified and so terrified that you touch me. You don't touch me. And these damn ignorant newspapers had a school day. They fussed in it. Well, we as Americans, we don't understand the protocol of the pompous. Damn their pomp. Damn their circumstance. Damn Queen Elizabeth. And the faggot press charger. And all of them dogs out of hell. Cannot go around. They're greater than the Torah of Yah. They form their own church. They form their own Anglican. They got a church, but they don't have no damn truth in it. Damn them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You that are in Britain, just write me and say, preach on, preacher. You're telling the truth. Hallelujah. And this slut will not embrace the humble. She's a dirty bastard. She's of the bastard slip. She has no father. And her little effeminate man, what she called Prince Philip, he's a faggot. All of them. They're dogs and pedophiles and freaks, rapists and sexual perverts. That's what they are. I will, man. Damn their Prince Andrew and Henry. Damn them all. Eberach Yisrael. Lay your strength upon your people. Restore us back to the joy that was once delivered unto us. Hell has enlarged itself without measure. Yeshua 14:10. This is what they're going to say now in Yeshua. Now, Yah said you're brought down to the pit of hell. And Yah said, all that shall speak and say to you. He's talking about Hashatan. He's talking about this government. He's talking about this man, this undegenerate man that has not the mind of Yahshua. They say, are you the one that has become chala? You become sick and sickly and weak. You have diseases. That's what they're going to say. They put their confidence in the arm of man and the strength of his ability, and they deny the strength of Yah. Yeshua says, your pomp, your gaon, your majesty and your pride, it is brought down to Sheol, and the noise of your string instruments and the worm of the tula, the maggots. The maggots is spread under you, and the worms cover you. And this is the catalyst here in verse 12. I want to try. I will. I have time. This is it here that we identify in the fullness of the manifestation of a king, of a man that had the mind, the government of Hashatan. We see the tenets of this government as I've read. This is what Yah says. He says here in Yeshua, hallelujah, 14:12, it says, how are you fallen from Hashemaam, O Hillel, O Hashatan, you that bear the light. He calls him the son of the morning. How are you cut down to the ground? How is a nation like this nation that has exalted itself above the very thresholds of Yah's creations and defied the very beauty of his majesty and exalt itself in the light as this nation is the light of the world? And they denounce the light of Torah, his commandments, his mitzvah, their lamps. It is the lamp and the light, and that's what the wise five had. They had the assurance of that all, of the near, the lap of Yah, His Torah, the light of the Torah, the commandments of Yah. He said, you're the one which Chalash, you did weaken or overthrow the nations. You are the one that in your evil power, is not this nation overthrown the nations of the earth? Is not America overthrown the nations of the earth? And that is what Babel, it is synonymous, it is of the same nature. The rulers of Babel, they are ones that have been empowered by HaShatan. It is synonymous with the nature and the workings of HaShatan, revealed in the mind of the workings of a man. That's why he speaks against, he said, let this be a mashal, a proverb, a mishli, against the melech of Babel. He did not say a Misraim, but a Babel. What a city. And it is her cities. A city is the city. I don't care if it's New York City, or San Francisco, or LA. The cauldrons of darkness and wickedness, are they not? I don't care if it's Charlotte, wherever. The cauldrons of darkness. How have you been brought down, cast down to the earth? How have you been brought down to the side of hell? How? Hallelujah. And then Yah began to express His nature. Look what He says in Yeshaya 14:13. For you have said in your lamp. That's what the king says. That's what America says. That's what the mark of the beast. That's one of the most diabolic nature of this mind. You have said in your left, I. If it's Yah's will, if it's His pleasure, I shall. I want you to pay attention to this now. He said, I. That's what Cayenne said. Am I? Did he say that? Am I my brother's keeper? And I will allow, I will ascend. I will shoot forth like the bright star. I will ascend into the heavens, Hashemayim. He says, and I will exalt, I will room, I will set on high. Hashatan said, my throne above, not beneath, but above the Kochab, the stars. Yah's might. He said, I will exalt myself above Yah, His omniscience power, His might, His beauty. Isn't that the mind of man? Nobody's going to control man. Isn't that what Yisrael said? Yah, no, He doesn't see us. We can do as we please. That is the mind of the beast. That is the nature of man. That is the will of HaShatan. I will do what I want to. Nobody's going to tell me. Have not we said that? Have not we all ordered that? Nobody's going to tell me. I can do what I want to. I'm a man. I'm a woman. You ain't going to tell me. No, I do what I want to. Well, I'm a body. You ain't going to tell me. I'll do what I want to do. It is the antithesis of the most hubris, arrogance of pride. Any time you begin to exalt, I. He said, I'm going to room. I will exalt. Yeah, you exalt an I. Because Yah commands the man. He commands the ish. He commands the ish. But when you say, I will do what I want to, you're wicked. Yes. Nobody's going to tell me you're wrong. Yes. Quiet, huh? Hallelujah. I will ascend above Yah, I will room, I will set myself on high above the throne of the stars of Yah. And this is profound here. He said, and I will sit also upon the hair of the mount of the congregation. Where is this congregation? He tells us. He said, in the side of the Safon of the north. I read to us, Yeshua, concerning the west, that Bethel was west. Hallelujah. Now let's examine this for a moment because it's important, Yisrael. Let's examine this north, this Safon. It says in the book of Tehillim, why does he want to exalt himself there? Why does he want the pinnacle of the mind of man? It says in Tehillim 48 verse 1, David said, as he sing great praises unto the great assembly of Yah in Yahshua, he says here in Tehillim 48 verse 1, he said, God, oh, great is Yah, and greatly to be hallel, to be praised. He talks about in the city of Araba, in the mountain of his set apartness. Verse 2. Beautiful or Yafeth, beautiful on high. Did not Hashatan said, I will ascend into the heavens above. Yah is on high. The joy of the whole earth in Mount Sion, Tezion, on the side now, of the north, of the Safon, on the side of the north, the city of the great king. And so Hashatan says, I am the Melech, I'm the great one. I will go beyond his omniscient power, his presence, and I will establish my throne there. That's what he tried with Yahshua. That's why he took him up into the high mountains and showed him all the kingdoms of the world. I believe it was north of Yerushalayim that he took him up. And he showed him all the kingdoms in a moment of time. He said, bow down and worship me. This will exalt my presence above Yah. And Yah will know that I'm mighty because you have surrendered unto me. And so he had failed at that. So what he is doing is utilizing the multitude of the people to worship, to exalt him, and to go before Yah as when the sons of Yah went to present themselves in Eob Dave, so did Hashatan come. And Yah said, have you considered my Evet Eob? Have you considered him? He's a man that walks upright. He hates evil. How did he hate it? Because he had a Torah of life in him. And the enemy says, you know what about him? You have a hedge all about him. He said, take the hedge down and I'll make him curse you to your face. I'll make him denounce you. Yah said, I'll take him down, save. You cannot even touch the breath in him. You're not going to touch my witness in him. You can lay your hands on his flesh, and he's allowed him to lay his hands on the flesh of Yisra'iyah. But that which he has written in us from the foundation of the earth, he can't touch that, Yisra'iyah. Everyone doesn't have that. He can't touch that Torah. He can't touch that truth. He can't touch that witness. He cannot touch that. Not at all, Yisra'iyah. You know what I'm saying? Touch the ember. You can touch him everywhere, but that you're not going to touch. He's going to not. He's never going to allow that. He's going to cause. He's going to present the occasion where all will take that marker. They will see the Yahs of no value to me. That's why Yisra'iyah, when they came out and then they got themselves and they saw what fix they were in, Yah put them in the fix. And then they began to murmur. The mixed multitude, we caused them to murmur. They said, hell, we should have stayed by the fresh pots of Mitzrayim. We had garlic, we had meat, we had mutton, we got fat, we could eat. And Moshe, you brought us into this wilderness, this be midbar to kill us, man. Yah said, I kill them all. Damn them all. Damn them all. They ain't worth a damn. They've seen my mighty works and my mighty hand. And it has no value to them. We have seen the works of Yahshua. We believe it by Emunah, it has no value to us. He will damn us all, Yisra'iyah. He will kill you, your babies, and all. And don't think he will not. In the north. Verse 3, Yahweh is known, he is Yada in her palaces or her places for a refuge. In the gates of the city of the north, Yah is known. He is a refuge for Yisra'iyah. He is a place of comfort. And assurance and great confidence, Yisra'iyah. That is why he said, I'm going to exalt my throne upon the mount of the congregation in the side of the north, in the Safon, where the city, where the place of Yah's heritage shall be dispensed, if he can get there. And that's why this mind here, it is always pointing up, isn't it? The mind is north, the head is the head. Come on, the feet is south. Come on. And this thing right here is up. The mind, the Laba, hallelujah. And that's what he wants. He wants the mind of Yisra'iyah. He is trying to, we are the heritage of Yah. He is trying to establish a government in the kingdom, Yisra'iyah, to draw us away from Yah. Again, Yeshua 14:1. Again, he said, I will ascend. I will lift myself up. I will roam. I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. Has man done that? Has he ascended? If you've ever ridden a road, an airplane, flown anywhere, they get up above the clouds. That's the first thing they do, get up above the clouds. I will ascend myself above the clouds, of the heights of the clouds. I will be like, see, notice again, I. How many I's? 3, 4. I will be like the Most High. That's the issue. And that is what Kayan. He said, I have the power to kill. I have the power to direct. I have the power to alter. That's what man is doing. That's the mark of man. He is always trying to alter. He is always trying to change. He said, and I will be like the Most High. I will bow down, worship me, Yahshua HaMashiach. And I will give you these kingdoms. I will be like the Most High. I will walk like him. And Yah says in verse 15, yet you shall be brought down to hell, the side of the boar of pit. Yah says you're going to be brought down to hell. You're going to be brought down. This is the mark of man and beast. There is only one place that can confine that. That's hell. There's no other place that can confine that. It can have liberties in the outer sphere and will find some way to corrupt and contaminate. Yah says you must be brought down to hell, and everything that you produce. One in his wise assessment of this matter, Shirach, in Shirach 21:9, he speaks. He talks about a congregation of the wicked. It's like a tow wrapped together. The end of them is a flaming fire to destroy them. He said, the way of a sinner is smoothly paved with stones, but the end thereof is the pit of hell. That's the end of the sinner. That's the end of the state of this man, the pit of hell. He gives us great strength of motivation in verse 11. He that Shema keep the Torah of Yah, he gets understanding. He gets understanding. Revelation, as I read, he is wisdom. Here is wisdom. Let him that has understanding. You must keep the Torah in order to get understanding of this mark and understand. You cannot deny the Torah. You just cannot look at Gilead and think you're going to understand this. It's not that way. Shirach says, he that keeps the Torah of Yah, he gets understanding thereof and control his thoughts. And the perfection of the fear of Yah is wisdom. Hallelujah. The perfection of the fear of wisdom. The fear of Yah is wisdom. It is the mark of a man, Yisra'iyah. He is pointing out a king. There was one that was parallel to him, or parallel to this tantamount ability of the king of Babel that represents the very nature of Hashatan. That's what Babel is. He talks about the king of the Pharaoh of Misraim, Yeskel, Ezekiah. Turn quickly, Ezekiel. Just one verse I want to read. He talks about this one who has the nature of Hashatan as he speaks about this one in Yeshaya. It says in Yeskel, Ezekiel 31:16, Yah says, I made the nations to shake at the sound of his fall. Mephileth, not Nephal, Mephileth. Of his destruction, his ruin. And Yah speaking of the mighty Pharaoh of the king of Misraim. When I cast him down to hell, to Sheol, with them that descended into the pit, and all the trees of Eden, the choice and the best of Lebanon, all that drink water shall be comforted in the netters or in the lowest parts of the earth. Yah says, those that have been dispersed, Israel, the people, he said, those that are mighty, he said, when I bring down the powers of hell, when I bring down the very nature of this mark, he said, those that, he said, even the ones that are strong and mighty, they're going to rejoice. Even in the lower parts, they're going to drink the water. What water? The living water. The refreshing water, the fountain of the Sisram, of the bosom of Yahshua HaMashiach. He said, the nation's going to rejoice. That's why Yah says, leave it alone. I just want you to have wisdom of the matter. Don't try to bring it down. Don't try to, you cannot usher me in before my time. You have wisdom. You mark a perfect man. For the way of that man is Sadiq. He's a man that walks in the Torah of Omar. Yah commands us to mark a perfect man. You mark a Sadiq man. For his way is one of Sadiq. And you walk in the steps that he walks. Don't trust man, that's folly. Hallelujah. Quickly, I will, friend. Quickly, Yeshaya 14:16. Yah says, they that see him shall narrowly look upon him and consider you. And saying, this is what they're going to say. Do you have that Isaiah 14:16? It says, and they that shall see him, that shall see you, shall narrowly look upon you. And they're going to consider you. And this is what they will say. Does it say in your rendition, is this the man? Does it say that?
Yes.
Is this the man? They're going to say, is this what you call a man? Is this the man that made the earth to raga, tremble, to shake, to move? Is this the man? The mark of a man and beast. Is this the man that caused the earth to tremble and did shake kingdoms? A man doing that? You tell me a man operating in the same spirit that the very anger of Yah. Is this the man that made the world a bitten mid bar, a wilderness, and destroyed the cities thereof? And he opened not the house of the prisons. And we're in prison too. It seems that way. It seems that way, doesn't it? He didn't even open the house of the prison. This is one nation that doesn't open the house of the prisons. Every 7 years, Yerushalayim, whatever the man's sin were, it was considered. Something small, they were blotted out. But look at what Yah speaks to us in Yeshaya. I'm sorry, in Gilyana, for your confidence and strength. Revelation 2:10, as he speaks unto the assembly of Smyrna, Yah tells us to fear none of those things which we shall suffer. He says, behold, Revelation 2:10, this is the nature of the beast. He never opens the house of the prisons, this oppression. He will drug you and dilute your mind. But look what Yah says to us. Fear none of those things. Revelation 2:10. Which you shall suffer. It says, behold, the devil. Does it say Hashatan? Does it say the devil? It says the devil, doesn't it? For the devil shall cast some of you into what? So prison, you must be a prisoner in order that the gate shall be open. He shall cast some of you in the prison that you may be tried. He said, and you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be you therefore faithful to death. And Yah said, I will give you a crown of life. And it seems as though that the gates of the prison house, there are those that are being bombarded in oppression and their homes. I was reading this morning where this one woman, how she would go to the restaurants at night. She winds up dead, her and her two children. She was poor. They would not even give the woman food stamps. She would go and beg them for the scraps that they were throwing away. And you think that we have something as a nation of people to complain about? You will go to hell as far as I'm concerned with your complaints. I don't give a damn what you say. She had a 12-year-old child and a 10-year-old child, and the only way she could not get food, she would beg. And yet we have a disdain for the abundance of Yah's blessings and his riches. And she would go to the restaurants at night and walk the streets at midnight when they were closing, begging or going and trying to get something to eat. And this damn oppressive system would not even give the woman food stamp. You feed the poor, don't give a damn what it is. I don't care if they are here illegal, feed them. I don't care, Yisra'iyah. Hell, they had to be poor where they were, then when they came here, they're still poor. And the damn jobs that these people take on, you're not going to work them. You're not going out there picking no damn beans. Come on here and work with me. I had a big fat preacher from Philly come down, he can't even handle bugs. Yeah, I said it that way, and I hope he hears it. Beasts. He couldn't even handle a bug. Run from a gnat. You're not going to go out there and pick the beans. I guarantee you, those that are listening, they could not work in the garden 2 hours in their back bin. You couldn't pick beans for an hour. You come here, we plow and plant all day long. All day. Until it's done. We start in the morning and it's finished that evening. You will feel something in your back, all right? Come on, Yisra'iyah. And that's the truth. And those that say, I got it made here, I do have it made, I'm telling you. to live among the few of Yah's people. We all fall short. We all not fun. But that's all right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'd rather be among you than out there in this world that doesn't give a damn about anyone. Watch the ones that have left from here and they think their kinsmen don't give a damn. Put them out, but not even give them a piece of bread. Why do they call me? Why? Because if there's any man that has some kind of decency, they know that. They know that. They know his heart. These bastards don't know. Speak against me. I love it. Hallelujah. 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 Yeshua 14:19. I have a few more verses I want to read here before I close. Yeshua 14:18. All the Melechim, or all of the kings of the nations of the Gohem, even all of them lie in splendor, everyone in his own grave. He says unto this king, this beast, he said, but you are cast out of your grave like an abominable branch. Was Yahshua the branch? Was he not the branch? Yes. He is the branch. Yes. He said, this one is cast out like a to'eba, an abominable branch. And as the remnant of those that are slain thrust through with the sword, that go down to the stone of the pit, as a carcass trodden under foot. Now, I want to deal with that to Abba for a moment here, all right? It says here in the book of Sirach, chapter 4, 41, verse 5. Listen, that's why Yah must eradicate the sons and the offsprings of Chayan out of the earth, because the cry of Hebel shall continue to rise up. It says in Sirach 41, 5, the children of sinners are abominable children. What is the sin of those that defile the Torah? Those that have the mark of man. And the mark of man is the defiance of the Torah of Yah. The children of the abominable, or the children of sinners, are abominable children. They are accustomed to dwelling with the wicked. They have no problem living with the wicked. They have no problem eating with the wicked. They have no problem sitting down with the wicked. Listen, although I was an ignorant man, when it came time to be a part of my natural kinsmen, the organizational structure, I would not be a part of it. I didn't participate. I didn't give a damn what they said about me. And they would look at me strange and say, look at him, who he think he is. I'm not going to be a part of that. And I don't give a damn how y'all feel about me. I'm not going to participate. Children that are evil, their conversation is evil. Their conversation is the conversation of the mark of a man. It's foolish. It's fallen. It's full of wickedness. It's full of despair for Yah. They talk about their damn gods and their wicked gods. Damn their gods. I'm not going to be a part of it. I wasn't a part of it. And so I was a castaway. I was cast out. But the children of sinners, they are abomination, they are abominable, they are to'eba, they are an unclean, vile thing. They're like a minister cloth of a woman for ministration. They're filthy, they're unclean, they're mad because they are children of sinners. Y'all say he will bring the curse upon your children, upon the fathers of the children that hate him, down to the third and the fourth generation. He ain't lying. No, not he is not lying. He ain't lying. He's going to bring it down, Yisrael, yeah. He's going to bring the curse down upon them. He is not lying. Hallelujah. I want to deal with this for a moment because that mind is the mind that is a perverse mind. It's a mind of lying. Anytime we as a nation of people, anytime we have this propensity and we have this natural flow to lie, something is twisted in your damn mind. You are wicked. You better get down on your damn dirty, filthy knees. You better get down on your damn dirty, filthy knees and say, Yah, get this out of me. I am a damnable damnation. I am an abominable vile thing. You better get that out of you. You better cry out unto Yah. I don't give a damn who you are. I don't give a damn about your petty, childish feelings. We're dealing with your nephesh, woman, your foolish man. You turn to God, you protect your damn wicked ways against Yah's Torah. Get that damn mess out of you. Yeah. Repent, make teshuva. Yeah.
That's the mind of a man. See, it's the mark of a man. Any time you begin to have sympathy for you, instead of hearing you and changing your damn wicked ways. That's what you do. You don't fight against Yah. You say it's me, Yah. Not my mama, not my brother, but it's me, oh Yah. Standing in the need of your deliverance. Oh, I need you, Yah. Need to learn how to be honest with Yah. Do you hear that? Those that defy Torah. You know it's a damn wicked thing to lie. Was not Hashatan a murderer and a liar from the beginning? Because your mind is not in Torah. The mind of man does not delight in Torah. It does not delight. That's why we must let the mind of Yahshua. Yah said their damn children are cursed. Even their children are an abomination unto Yah. Hallelujah. Well, I don't believe that. Well, I'll move a little further. Hallelujah. Look what Shaul says in the book of Titus. Hallelujah. He shows us the nature of this abominable wicked one. Hallelujah. Is this not the nature of Hashatan? I want to show you now. It says in Titus 1:16. I want to show you whether you are abominable, what we are abominable. This is the nature of man. This is the nama of man. Every word that Yah speaks has a nama to it, Yisra'yah. And it all, when it is written down in the Hebraic, it all equates to that number. And you go, you must, it's more of a numeric thing. It's not difficult, but it's a time-consuming thing in order to understand the numerics of his speech and his numbers. It really is, Yisra'yah. That's why a messenger, he needs time to study. You need men that can labor in the Torah. I'm not talking about sit on our ass and eat and do nothing. I'm talking about labor in the Torah. And so when you go out and labor, the labor is sweet. You're not complaining about the labor. I don't complain about laboring. I labor as hard as any man. Shaul writing to his confidant Titus, Titus 1:16, he said, this is the nature of the abominable. They profess that they yada yada, they know Yah, but in works they deny him. They deny Yah. Titus 1:16. He said, being abominable. If your works deny Yah, you are abominable. If your works deny Yah, you are abominable. He said, being abominable, and they're disobedient. They don't obey the Torah. Condemning every Tov Mitzvah, everything that is right, they condemn. Everything that is right, they condemn his name. They condemn Shabbat. They condemn the works of Yah. They're abominable, Yisra'yah. You don't have to work on the Shabbat. You got these grinning damn devils telling folks they don't have to work. Hallelujah. I tell you all this. If you leave from here, I can't stop you from living your hope. You got to be shallow as duck's dung that you are so convinced and someone so easily persuade you from truth. You got to be less than a jackass, a pile of jackass dung. That's a fact. I don't care if you don't like me. You hold fast to that which is tough. If it's right, you keep it. You don't cast that aside. I don't care what your mother said or your father said, your ima, your avat. I don't care how you got upset with them. You don't cast aside the tough things they told you. I didn't cast aside the tough things my mother told me. It was part of my nurturing and my growth. You don't cast that aside. And if you had any strength, you know, you're not easily convinced. You're the one that convinced others. A weak man, he is easily convinced. These weak jackasses, they're easily convinced. Well, you can't eat chicken. Who says so? There's no one in the Torah where tells us not to eat chicken. He gives us types and prototypes. I had one to say to me, well, you ever seen what a chicken eat? I said, yeah, I've seen what they eat. They eat anything. They eat bugs. They eat anything. They eat human dung. They love Turkish shit. I said it like that. They'll stretch through cow shit and all. Ooh, they're so nasty. Well, I'll tell you what, go to the pond and see what a bass eat. Throw some Turkish shit in there and see what they will eat. You're a dumb jackass what you are. They will eat Turkish shit. They will eat a rotten body. They eat the same thing that a chicken will eat. They love human dung. You take some human dung and go down there and throw it in the pond. They will hit that faster than they will hit cotton candy. Talk to me. Herod was a young boy. We had to go to the woods and duck there. And then we would take that mess and throw it in the water and wash the fish. Da, 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 da. You ain't talking to a fool. I've been there. Hallelujah. He gives us types of things. And that represents spiritual things above all things. There are types of things we ought not to eat, Yisra'iyah. And we eat chicken. Man, I love chicken. You can send me all your chicken. We'll eat it here, all right. Make sure it's free range. How about that? Damn fools. A double-minded man is unstable. You can tell them anything. And they will beat to the drum. You got to have a warrior. You got to know he's a warrior. I don't want to go to battle with a man that is weak and insecure and unsure. I don't want to go to battle with a man that can't confront me. You confront me, then I'm ready to fight with you. Hell, I'll go down to the lowest parts of hell to fight with you. Sure I will. I go to the depths of the earth to fight. But don't be a coward. Don't be a coward. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen quickly here in Revelation chapter 17. This is the mind. It is an abominable mind. It is one that is full of disobedience. Revelation chapter 17, verse 4. Hallelujah. As Yochanan saw this woman bring forth the excellence, or bring forth this child, this spirit, this birth in the mind of many. He says in Revelation 17, 4, he said, "The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet cover, and she was decked with gold and precious stones." Well, I know they say that's the Catholic Church, but these are the kuluras of Yisra'iyah. I got a message. I'll teach it one day. But listen, it is a religious attitude. That's what it is. Having a golden cup in her hand. This is what she has now. A golden cup in her hand, full of abomination and filthiness to Abba, filthiness of her idolatrous worship, her corrupt type of practices. A cup full of abomination. And upon her forehead, again, it's important to understand the forehead, and we will get into that next week. That's why I'm going to finish this today, because I want to go there next Shabbat. The number that is written where? And upon her forehead was written, Mystery Babel. Was not this the king of Babel? Was that not the king I just read about in Yeskel? In Isaiah, was that not the king? O king of Babel, was it not the king of Babel? He saw this, even Yochanan, it says, he saw this abominable this abominable vile nature and the dregs of the cup, and she was known as Mystery Babel the Great. She is the mother of all whores, of harlots, and the abominations of the earth. She produced every kind of vile thing it is. Written in her forehead. Written. I'll take us there next week now, all right? I don't want to rush. I'm rushing too much today, and I don't like that. See, this really is a two-part, three-part message for me to fill in all the details. I couldn't use all the scripture that I wanted to use, all right? But I'm going to finish this out today, all right? Hallelujah. And I want to finish out from Yeshaya. One more point I want to bring out of the destruction of HaShatan and us, that and those that would not obey Yah. Shaul writes in 2 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonica, the second letter that he writes unto them. He said, there's one that's going to be revealed, 2 Thessalonians 2:8. And then shall the wicked one, or the wicked, be revealed, whom the Master Yeshua will consume with the ruach of his mouth. He's going to destroy him with the brightness of his coming. He tells us this one now. It is the mark of man, and it is the mark of beast. It is the government of the beast kingdom united with man that we receive the 666. I will bring all that out, show you in the numerics of the number 6, what it represents throughout from the Bereshit unto Gilead. I will show us that in the time, in the teachings to come. He says in verse 9, even him, there's one. Was not this king that I read about? Was he not the king of Babel? Did not we just read in Gilead now, in the forehead or the eyebrow was written Mystery Babylon? This is his nature. Look at this. Are these threes? She was called the Mystery of Babel. That's one, right? The mother of harlotry. That's two.
and the abomination of the earth. That is three, the number three, right? Three twice is man. Three twice. So that's what it is. Three. So these are the three components of the very mark of this beast mind. It is one that the mysteries, don't all these organizations have their mysteries? All of the Masons, all of them, even the church houses, the whole houses, they don't share with you their rite of passages and all of that. Come on. And they have been birthed from the mother of all abomination. What is an abomination? Everything that is unclean and vile that disrepresents the Torah of Yah and that abandons the order of Yah's Torah, Yisrael Yah. I will bring all these things out. Jahweh says in 2 Thessalonica 2 and 9, even him whose coming is after the working of HaShatan, he's coming with power and signs and lying wonders. He's coming with lying wonders. He is coming with all deceit of unrighteousness in them that perish. Why? It's all about one thing, truth. Because they receive not the love of the Torah that they might be delivered. And they're going to see this delusion that they think. It's one thing that if you read the story of Lamech, he thought that the one, he was the first after Ka'an, he was the second to commit murder. See, that's one. The mark of man's 1/6. The mark of the beast 6. And the mark of the unity of that government in one mind, that one opposition that they are against Yah, 666. And he thought that this young man was out to do him harm, and he killed him. He murdered him. He was the first to take upon two wives. See, we should not be halted between two opinions. And that's what this nation is about. Where the opinion of man, the judgment of man, and the judgment of Yah. We don't want the judgment of Yah. Why are we halted between two opinions? Why? We should not be. There's only one judgment that makes. An opinion is a judgment. There's only one judgment that is true and right. That's the judgment of Almighty Yah. Period. Hallelujah. Quickly back to Yeshaya. Four verses, and I'm going to close here. I'm wore out. Yeshaya 14:20. Yah says, you're going to be joined with them in burial because you have destroyed your land. And look what he has done. He has slain his people. Does it say that? You have slain your people? See, you all think I'm just talking. Didn't mean he will kill his babies to get to Yisrael. He wants to find us. And have we become so immersed with the nations, the Goyim? Yah said that Abraham will be the father of Goyim nations, not just one. Ishmael was just the father of a nation. Come on, Yisrael. He didn't have nations. He would be the father of Goyim. Nations. He'll become so much like the nations and like man that he said, hell, I got to kill all of them. You must understand he doesn't abide in truth. He doesn't know the power of spiritual truth. He understands the letter, but he doesn't know the power. That's why many of these folks, they just understand letter, but they don't understand truth. He said, again, Yeshaya 14:20, you shall be joined with him in burial because you have destroyed your land, you have slain your people. He said, the seed of evildoers shall never be renowned. You shall never be karaj, you shall never be proclaimed their children. Prepare slaughter. Does it say for her or his? Yes. His. So we know that we're dealing with a man, yes, or subject, don't we? Yes. Prepare his children for the iniquity of their father. Can Yah lie? Did he not say he will visit iniquity upon the children of the fathers that hate him down to the third and fourth generation? He cannot lie. That they do not rise. He's got to eradicate the nation of Kayan and the spirit of Kayan. They do not rise again and possess the land, nor fill the face of the earth with city. That's why the voice of Hebel cries out, eradicate Yah, destroy, bring down the. For I will rise up against them, says Yah of Sabaoth, of the army of hosts, and I will cut off from Babel the name, the remnant, the son, the nephew, says Yah. I'm going to cut off the man. There will be no man. That's why if we can't find a man among us, woe unto us. I'm going to cut them off. Because the nature of man, why he must cut off, he says the son, the remnant, the name, son, nephew. Is a nephew a girl or a boy? Okay, is a son, a girl, or a boy? All right, okay then. The mark of man. It's in their sons and in their nephews and their children. Verse 23 as I close. And I'll also, Yah said, I will also make it a possession to the bitrin or the kippot for the unclean animals. It really has no meaning. I can't find it. They say the porcupine or the hedgehog, whatever. He said, and pool of water. And I will sweep the besom of destruction, says Yah. He says, I'm going to make it almost like the bitrin, an animal whereby, there's nothing like a porcupine, those quills, you get one of them bad. I've simply read and saw, you get one of those quills in you, you're in trouble, you're going to cry. And Yah said, it shall be pools of water, and I will sweep. The pools shall be their own iniquity. It shall be the sin of man, a man that is obstinate against Yah and defies Yah. And it shall be represented in the eyebrows, the forehead. I will continue there next week. May Yah barach you, all Yisrael. I'm tired. I feel it in my back, standing here all this time, all right? You may feel it in your hippies, but I feel it there, all right? The tents and all of that, all right? That's all right. Hallelujah. That people work all day and they sit on their hips. May Yah barach you, all Yisrael. May you all do assist us in the live view stream. You that are enjoying that. Beautiful. Okay. Beautiful visit today. Do assist us in that. You know I'm not a beggar. Yabarak, you all be encouraged, Yisrael. And don't be a part of that damn pagan Christmas. Stay away from it. Let us stand to our feet. As we turn toward Yerushalayim, Almighty Yah, we do barak you for all things. We pray for our Rechutz, Blunt, and her family. You touch her body, her mouth. And we do barak you for the report on our Ach Yaqub. There in Jacksonville, Florida. Granted that he can go home soon. We do pray that he was able to join us today in the live broadcast. And our precious Ach and friend Ach, that we Nesha in his home there in Birkenhead, Scotland. And also our precious Ach David, his Isha, his wife Suzanne Yah there in Britain. Bless them. We barak you for their gift, their offerings, and the kindness of their bosom. Grant it back unto them 24s, Yah. We ask in Yahshua's name, we ask you to take our Ach Shimri, Zachin Shimri down the highway with this Yeshua and Chot, Jennifer and all of those, Yah, and our Ima, Eunice Barach, in Yahshua's mighty name, keep us in love with you, that we may have wisdom and understand all things. Bless us all on this Shabbat, and we shall take our rest and our bow in Yahshua HaMashiach, yeah. With our voices, we cry, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen, hallelujah. Yabarak Yisrael.